our yogas. In this fashion, as children of God, representing various churches and fellowships and denominations, to worship Him in spirit and in truth, to fellowship with one another, and to meditate from His holy word. I want to really thank God for the privilege that is mine to be spending the last 1 full week here with the people in this part of this world. I am really thrilled to know and notice that God is definitely moving both in individual hearts and also in corporate fellowships. And I believe the restoration that God has promised for us in His holy word is very much on the way. But we should not stop. We should not get discouraged if we come across things which are not so encouraging, and we should keep pressing on. May the Lord give us grace, especially this evening, as we go to the meditation of God's Word. I would like to begin my talk making a few statements. The church that is not the church that was. The church that is not the church that should be either. I would repeat the statement, it looks rather complex. The church that is not the church that was. And the church that is not the church that should be. Maybe, if God through His Holy Spirit should make an assessment of how we conduct ourselves as individual Christians, or corporately as churches and fellowships, uniformly, perhaps with a little bit of exception on our side, uniformly, there will be one statement that would be written on the entrance of most of our churches and also in our lives. Weighed and found wanting. Weighed and found wanting. I personally believe, after very closely and very intently studying the 7 letters of the Lord Jesus Christ, written to the then 7 churches in Asia, which represent the wide spectrum of all the churches which have ever existed on the face of the earth, beginning with that birthday of the church, that the day of Pentecost, until perhaps the 21st century. I believe we all have come short of God's expectation. We have been satisfied with status quo because things seem to be reasonably going all right with us. But I believe it is here the message of the Lord comes to the church of Jesus Christ. Arise and shine. Awake out of your slumber. Become vigilant. Remember where from you are fallen. Repent of your present condition. Redo the things that you once were known for. Now I have just put a revival call and the restoration of call of all the Old Testament prophets and the New Testament apostles together during the last 3-4 minutes. That's the message in sum and total. Why is it that we are not what the church once was, and we are not where we should be? There could be so many reasons. We will do some dissection this evening. Not to criticize or condemn anyone, but that we would take it for our own personal self-assessment and self-examination. Too long we have been looking around at others. The time has come that the judgment begins at the house of God. Now that is what the clear teaching of the scriptures. Because I believe, as the church goes, so goes the world. Let me say that again. As the church goes, so goes the world. Tell me the condition of a community or a society, I will tell you the condition of the church over there. Because Jesus very correctly and categorically He said, you are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. If the salt shall lose its savor, Wherewithal shall it be salted again, except to be trampled underfoot? And if the light that is in you has become darkness, how great will be that darkness? I know some of the statements I make during this course of this message will be rather pretty strong, but they are not too much to digest, because we have gathered here with a spirit of expectation and prayer that God, through His Word and through His Spirit, will minister to each of us very personally and very practically. One of the reasons why we are not what we should be is that we have been too long majoring on minors but failing in majors. Majoring on minors but failing in majors. This was pointed out by the Lord Jesus Christ Himself about the religious people of His day. Turn with me, if you have brought your Bibles, to Book of Matthew, chapter 23 and verse 24. In case you do not have a copy of your Bible, may I request you humbly and sincerely to please look at the Bibles of your neighbors. It is not enough if you just look at me and listen to my voice. It is very much necessary, or even more important, that you look into your Bibles and see for yourselves whether things are so. We have come here not to listen to a lecture, but we have come here to learn together the Word of God. I want you to please open your Bibles to Book of Matthew, chapter 23, and I will read to you verse 24. Blind guides who strain on a gnat and swallow a camel. And look at verse 23. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees and hypocrites! Why does He say woe unto them? You pay tithe of mint and aloes and cumin, but you have neglected the weightier matters of the law. Weightier. You are doing 101 things, but you have left the weightier matter. In other words, you have left out that which is more important. 101 things drain you of all your energy and your enthusiasm. And at the end of the day, when you want to take a stock of your life, you find that the major things have been very conveniently and comfortably left out and forgotten. And that is why, in our Christian life, we lose purpose. We lose direction. And there is a lack of fulfillment consistently throughout. Now this evening, I would like to draw your attention to seven things in the Bible which God would have us to do as the primary major things in our life. I would title my message this evening like this: First Things First. First Things First. There are many other things which are perhaps important, but we are going to talk about things which are necessary. It is necessary that we understand the difference between the word necessary and the word important. 101 things may be important, but what is necessary for us to consider and concentrate on. Seven things I have picked up from the Holy Bible, especially from the New Testament, which I believe must get all our attention, all our life, in all that we do. Mark my words. Seven things we should have our attention and concentration all our life, in all that we do, all the time, with no exception whatsoever. The first thing, the first priority, is inward purity. Now all the key texts that I will turn your attention to this evening will have uniformly the word first occurring in it. I have picked them up. I went through this study for my own personal life, because all my life I had been a leader, and all my life I had been a minister of the Word of God, and all my life people were looking unto me for guidance, for advice, for counsel, for exhortation, and for help, and for prayer. So that sometimes filled me up so much that in my own life I have lost the sense of reality. I seem to be doing too many things, but finally I found that which was essential did not get enough of my attention and concentration. So what the Lord spoke to me and what the Lord dealt with me personally over the years, especially during the recent past, I am sharing with you. So the message of this evening will not just be an exposition, but it also will be a testimony of someone's experience. So I would like you to be encouraged in the course of this message and be challenged along with being convicted. The first thing that we should prioritize in our lives is inward purity. Mark my words, I don't say purity, but I say inward purity. Keep your Bibles again open to the same passage where we began. Matthew's Gospel, 23rd chapter. I will read to you from verse 25 to 28. I'm sure that this is a familiar passage to most of us. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees and hypocrites! You cleanse the outside of the cup and dish, but inside they are full of extortion and self-indulgence. Blind Pharisee, first cleanse the inside. Underline that word, first. Blind Pharisee, first cleanse the inside of the cup and dish, that the outside of them may be clean also. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees and hypocrites, for you are like whitewashed tombs, which indeed appear beautiful outwardly, but inside are full of dead men's bones and all uncleanness. Even so, you also outwardly appear righteous to men, but inside, you are full of hypocrisy and lawlessness. Now that which should really bother us tonight is that whole issue of hypocrisy. If you want to know what hypocrisy is, go to the church. Now that's the place where we get the definition, and that's the place where we get the demonstration, and that's the place where we also get the declaration of sublime, crystallized form of hypocrisy. What is hypocrisy? Hypocrisy is very simple. You act. You show something outwardly, but you are totally somebody else or something else inside. If you very carefully read this 23rd chapter, especially these words in your Bibles, if you have a Bible where the words of Christ are given in red, now this chapter, the entire chapter is all red. These are all the directly spoken words of our dear Lord. And you find so many times he uses the word O-E-O-W-O-E. It means curse. See how many times he uses the word woe in this chapter. First in verse 13. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees and hypocrites. 14th verse. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. 15th verse. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. 16th verse. Woe to you, blind guides. And then come to verse 23. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees. Verse 25. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees and hypocrites. Verse 27. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees and hypocrites. And verse 29. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees and hypocrites. Was Jesus unkind? Do we see that Jesus here, who unnecessarily and unconsciously lost his temper when he was giving the discourse in this chapter? I do not think so. He was perfectly in his balance and in his symmetry. But why? So successively, consecutively, and at a quick succession at that, he kept on pronouncing the word as someone who came to give peace to the world, as someone who came to heal the wounds of the broken hearted, as someone who came to preach the gospel to the poor, as someone who came to just heal the wounds of those who were ill-treated, who were marginalized. Why should he use this awkward word which nobody would like to use or hear from the pulpit? Oh, 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 we want people to be blessed. He was the blessed of blessers. But why did he repeatedly use the word woe? He never said woe to you, adulterers. He never said woe to you, idolaters. He never said woe to you, murderers. If you very carefully study the Gospels of the Lord Jesus Christ, he said, oh, only to one particular group, that is to hypocrites. No sin is more serious and horrendous. No sin is more hellish than the sin of hypocrisy. Because that is something which tries to deceive God, which we cannot. And it totally deceives people whom we come into contact with. There we have in the Old Testament that woman Hagar, she was sent out of her mistress with a little child. And she was there in the wilderness. And there she gave a name to Jehovah God. That name is what name I believe must be restored to our pulpits and our pews. You know what she said? You are a God who sees me. You are a God who sees me. Many times we take that word only for God's provision in our lives. But we never think of that verse for God's purification in our lives. Oh God, you see me. He knows everything. By trying to play hypocrisy, we are wasting our time and our energy. John the Demon, if you read John's Gospel, he presented Christ by various comparisons. Door, shepherd, vine. You see, lots of illustrative examples are given to bring out the characteristic ministries of the Lord Jesus Christ. And there are two things which he primarily said, if you can remember and recollect. The Lamb of God, the light of the world. Right at the early chapters of the book of John. You know, that's a divine book. Now, Matthew Gospel speaks very much to the Jews, and Mark's Gospel to Romans, and Luke's Gospel to the Gentiles. But when you come to John's Gospel, it's an universal message. Now, in that message, there are two things which stand out. He is the Lamb of God, and he is also the light of the world. Now, we Christians, we have taken that one side of the coin, that is the Lamb of God, he takes away the sins of the world. But we have forgotten to take the other side. He is the light who lights every man who comes into the world. When you say that he is the Lamb of God, that speaks about our salvation. But when you say that he is the light of the world, that speaks about our sanctification. We stop with salvation and never move on unto sanctification. We come to Jesus every time as the Lamb of God, but we dare not approach him as the light who opens up and enter even into the interior recesses of our lives to open up things and bring us to the surface to show us where we are, so that along with Isaiah the prophet, even one who was able to bring out so many prophecies concerning Messiah as a major prophet, he said, woe unto me, I am undone, I am a man of unclean lips, because my eyes have seen the King. Now my prayer for me and my prayer for every one of us who is gathered here is that we get a fresh vision of the holiness of God. And once you get the fresh vision of the holiness of God, you also get a fresh vision and understanding of your hollowness and your hellishness. Inward purity. Take time in your life if you want never to become a hypocrite. Hypocrisy does not visit you just all of a sudden. It grows steadily. Let me say that again. Hypocrisy does not just knock you down all of a sudden. It generally grows steadily. You try to excuse small things. And then once you excuse a few things here and there in your life, at the same time you want to show before others that everything is alright with you, then you try to cover up a little bit. And the fellowship gets damaged. But the Bible says, if we say he is in the light, let us walk in the light as he is in the light. And it is only when we walk in the light we have fellowship in one another. In many of our fellowships, there is no fellowship because there is not a hypocrisy. We call it fellowship, but there is no fellowship in our fellowships. The reason is very simple and very obvious and very open. Because as long as there is hypocrisy and that is not dealt with and rooted out, true fellowship is not possible. How is your life tonight? Are you honest or are you hypocritical? I'm not asking whether you are perfect or not. The Bible says, if we walk in the light as He is in the light. So the Bible is not there emphasizing perfection. The Bible at that point is emphasizing transparency. If we not walk in the light as He is in the light, transparency. Dear brothers and sisters, if you are not careful to deal with hypocrisy in your lives, in course of time, your root also will be rotten. If your root is rotten, the tree is just about to fall off. The Bible says, if the root is holy, the branches will be broken. Our problem in the modern Christian world is to just deal with branches. The externals. That which is above ground. But God is interested in the root. That's why John the Baptist came with a message so emphatically and forcefully. What did he say? Right now, the axe is laid, not at the branches, but at the root of your tree. God is interested in the root of anything that is rotten in our lives. I'm just bringing so many scripture passages together and put them all together, and I'm standing here with a prayer. The Holy Spirit will really coordinate these thoughts into your heart and minister to you. And not just enlighten your mind, but this must really equip you in your heart to be the kind of person that God wants you to be. Inward purity is the first thing. It's a major thing. There's something that we should constantly work at. And that is possible by reading the Word of God again and again. Day before yesterday, I preached about the practical benefits of the Word of God. When time permits, you try to get the DVD and you watch it. I could not have perhaps explained it any better. It is the Word of God. It's a mirror. It doesn't tell a lie. It doesn't give us any distorted figure of ourselves as we just read the Bible. And I made a statement, if you remember, as you read the Bible will read you. The Bible is a mirror. It just opens up. It shows you as you are, because the Bible does not compromise. We may compromise on the interpretation of the Bible, but never compromises in its message to us. That's why the Bible says, heaven and earth shall pass away. Everything will keep changing, but the Word of God, never. Whichever country you are, whichever culture you are found in, whichever community you may belong to, the Word of God does not change it according to you. The Word of God is established forever in eternity. David the psalmist began to celebrate about the Word of God in Psalm 119. The second thing that should get our priority, which we should consider as the major thing in our lives, is eternal values. Eternal values. I have picked the words which most of us have learned even from our Sunday school days. Matthew's Gospel, 6th chapter. Shall I read to you from verse 31 to 34? Therefore, do not worry. Please keep your Bibles open. Don't feel lazy to turn to your scripture passages if necessary. It is by turning to the Bible references as you listen to a Bible teacher, you get accustomed and then you get developed in working knowledge of the scriptures. Matthew 6th chapter, read from verse 31. Do not worry saying, what shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or what shall we wear? For after all these things, the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. But seek first, underline that word first. I told you, all the key references, we have that word first inscribed there. Maybe when you come across that word first there, don't just underline, you can perhaps insert it if you have a good ball pen. Seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. Do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about its own things. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. You know, here Jesus Christ is giving a difference between Christians and non-Christians. He is not giving a difference between spiritual Christians or carnal Christians. He is giving a difference between Christians and non-Christians. He uses the word heathen. In some translations, the word that is used is pagan. So if anyone thinks of all that they should have and all that they should yearn and all that they should enjoy and all that they should save for tomorrow, that person unconsciously, even though he thinks that he's a Christian and he's baptized as a Christian into a church, still, according to God's standard, he's still a heathen. Because he doesn't doesn't realize that he has a heavenly father who will take care of the rest of the things, provided he minds first and foremost things pertaining to the kingdom of God. I had this verse, Matthew 6:33. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you, even from my student days. I didn't have a Voltex printer those days. I just wrote it down in a piece of paper, on a drawing paper, and with whatever coloring I could do, I just had it fixed up just against the table where I used to have my studies. That I kept it all through my college days, when I was doing my 5 years engineering course, and when I was doing my 2 years master's, and when I was working in the CMC hospital in Belu from 71 to 75. All these years, that was the text that was always before. So that I would be constantly reminded, lest I any time sidetrack. It's easy to sidetrack. To go on the right track is very difficult. Going off tangent is always very easy. I don't know whether you are aware of it. Backsliding is easy, but climbing up is always more difficult, isn't it? Even in the neutral gear, you can just slide back. But if you want to go up, you need to go on from one gear to the other gear to the other gear. Most of us, when we come to neutral gear, you know, that's the beginning of just sliding back. Because not only the slope is downwards, but also there are forces that are just pulling us upon, pulling us down. That trend, the trend of this world. That's why Jesus said, now don't join the trend of the world. That's not the worldly fashion. That's the worldly way of looking at things. But you seek first. It says, but seek first. I like that word but, as well as the word first in Matthew 6:33. Lots of you young people who are listening to me, have this as the dictum of your lives. Whatever you do, studies, career, training, whatever you do, always have God and things pertaining to God as the primary and the foremost thing in your life. If you do that, all other things shall be added unto you. All other things are simply secondary. But if we are always concentrating on these earthly things, you know what the Bible says? Turn with me to 1 Corinthians 15th chapter and look at the 19th verse. Now, these are all challenges we have in the Holy Word of God. 15, 19 of 1 Corinthians. If for this life only we have hope in Christ, even praying sometimes is all about earthly blessings. If for this life only, or if in this life only, we have hope in Christ, and all our prayers are for the blessings of this life, we are of all men most pitiable. Another translation says, we are of all men most miserable. Sometimes we don't find our prayer very exciting. You know why? Just find out the subject of your prayer. It's the subject of your prayer that adds fuel to your prayer. Those of you who are with Christ in the school of prayer, you'll understand and appreciate what I'm saying. It's the subject that stands out in your prayer that will tell of the quality of your prayer. Someone who is occupied with eternal things, his prayer life will be heavenly. His prayer altar will never lack the fire from heaven. But someone who is occupied all the time with the earthly blessings and keep on asking for that, I tell you, his prayer life will become miserable. There will not only be the absence of fire on his prayer altar, his whole life will be frozen in it. That's what the Bible says. If for this life only, if for the needs of this only, we just have hope in Christ and faith in Christ and belief in Christ, we are of all most pitiable or miserable. The temporariness of this world should be constantly held in mind and in focus. That's where the Bible says, Colossians 3rd chapter, 3rd verse, seek those things which are above. Don't mind the things that are just around. Set your mind on things which are above. In the first verse of Colossians 3rd chapter, it says, seek. And in the next verse, it says, set. It is when we seek and keep on seeking, finally we get set there. Set your mind on things above. I want to tell you, dearly beloved, I'm sure several of you have come to the conclusion, but if you have not come to that conclusion, you will be wasting your time and coming in constant circles and never reaching anywhere. You know what? Spiritual things alone satisfy. I want to repeat that. Maybe you're a young person or a middle-aged person or you're an elder. But I want to tell you, in this world, spiritual things alone satisfy. Any other enjoyment, any other so-called benefit or blessing, they are extremely temporary in satisfaction and enjoyment. Just a little. But eternal things satisfy you forever. No one grows tired of praying if he prays for the right things. No one grows tired of reading the Bible if he reads the Bible and meditates it rightly. No one grows tired of sharing the Word of God if he is constantly motivated by the love of God that constrains us. I was born again in the year 1962 while I was a fresher in college. From day one, now I am 61, that happened in 16. Until this day, there is only one thing that is constantly on the increase, passion for souls. Because I have found my way to heaven, how can I but tell my fellow men and fellow women the way to heaven? I can't but do it. And the desire is growing all the time. Retirement is from an organization, but I have not been able to retire from sharing the Word of God. There are times when I'm not able to stand and preach. Just last November I had a back surgery, that was an emergency surgery. I have some problems. So there are times when I won't be able to stand and preach. I immediately ask for a chair, I sit and preach, why not? Because I'm still able to speak even when I'm not able to stand. That's a consuming thing. Let me say that again. Nothing but spiritual things satisfies. Nothing but that. That is why that rich man who had all that he wanted for his generation, for the next generation, and for many, many future generations, God visited him one night. What did God tell him? Oh fool. Oh fool. It's foolishness. Dear beloved, unless we are very conscious in this area, we will get into all sorts of trouble. Especially we are in this part of the world where we have reasonable affluence. Enjoying the affluence of the world, enjoying the blessings and the material benefits of this world, in itself it is not sin. But when we are caught up with it, when our heart seeks after monetary benefits, material goodies, the Bible says, the love of money is the root of all evil. It's not the root of evil. If it's just the root of evil, it's okay. But it's the root of... I don't think there is one unnecessary extra word in the Bible. As a Bible teacher, I believe in the verbal inspiration of the scriptures. You can't take one word away from the scriptures and still keep it intact. Every word of God is pure. And the Bible says, the love of money, not money in itself, but our attachment to the money. It is not whether you have money or not, but the question is whether the money has you. You know, that makes all the difference. If, for whatever reason, all the money and all the blessings and all the material provisions that you have are just in a moment, just like the tsunami would come and then sweep people away, if everything is taken away from you, if you could join Prophet Habakkuk, and if you are able to say, though the victory may not blossom, though there may be no flock in the stall, though the olives may be just fruitless, yet rejoice in the God of my salvation. If that is what you can honestly testify, not just recite from Book of Habakkuk, if you can honestly testify from your own spirit and heart, each of us, we know ourselves. I don't need to tell you who you are. You know who you are. That's a very important thing. I don't need to tell you who you are. You know who you are. You know how much you are attached to the material things of this world. You know whether you have money or money has you. You know that. Even as I'm preaching tonight, may the Lord give you grace to get yourself totally detached from the love and lust of things of this world. Because if man loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. I don't say that, the Bible says it. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. The third thing that should have our attention, to have our priority, is right relationships. Right relationships. Will you please turn with me to Matthew's Gospel, 5th chapter. Now most of these references are from Matthew's Gospel, because of all the four Gospels, it is in the Matthew's Gospel we have lots of discourses of the Lord Jesus Christ. Lot of short and long sermons. Matthew 5th chapter, reading from verse 21 to 24. You have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not murder, and whoever murders will be in danger of the judgment. But I say to you, that whoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment. And whoever says to his brother, rascal, shall be in danger of the council. But whoever says, you fool, shall be in danger of hellfire. Therefore, if you bring your gift to the altar, and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar. Go your way. First be reconciled to your brother. Underline that word, or insert that word, first. First be reconciled to your brother, and then come and offer your gift. You know, those days people, in these days we are just sending the money bags or the collection plates to the congregation and ushers go to collect. But those days people went in queues towards the altar or towards the, the place where the scripture was read from a podium or a pulpit. Now that was a habit both in the temple and also in the synagogue. So that's the habit Jesus Christ is referring to. He said, when you come to the altar, and there you are standing with your gift, and you want to offer it unto God. There you remember. What does it mean? Why should you remember that your brother has got something against you when you come to give? You are very conscious about the offering that you are giving to God, and you are conscious about the dress that you are wearing that other congregation members are watching. Normally, in the churches, that is what we are very conscious of, right? Especially when you go in a queue to offer to the front. No, I am talking about myself. How do you suddenly become conscious of your brother having something against you? Beloved, whatever spiritual activity we are involved in, we must be consciously self-examining ourselves in the light of God for acceptance and acceptable to Him. We are dealing with eternal matters and we are dealing with God. God is not a playmate for us. The reverence for God should throw us into self-examination and assessment. So when you come to the altar of the gift, just keep thinking whether you are alright. Whether your relationships are alright. And then you suddenly remember. It's not somebody pointing out saying, oh, you are wrong. No. You yourself remember that your brother has something against you. Not that you have done anything against you, but your brother feels that you have done something against him. It's not what you feel, but your brother feels. If you feel like that, you know what Jesus said? There's no point in offering your gift, because that gift may be recorded in the church register, but it did not be recorded up there. So don't offer that gift. He said, leave the gift. The word used is leave the gift. It's not offer the gift. Leave the gift on the altar. Just leave it there. Nobody will take it. Leave the gift at the altar. First go, get reconciled. And then come and offer the gift. Because if you are not right with men, you cannot be right with God. If you cannot love those whom you have seen, how can you love God whom you have not seen? Now, Jesus Christ ties up the eternal principles together when he gave these biblical prescriptions. First, get reconciled. Why do we have interpersonal relationship problems? I want to spend some time on that. Because there is no fellowship, there is no mission, there is no church, and there is no family without interpersonal relationship problems. Am I right? If there is one man, there is no problem. If there are two men, there is problem. And if there are two women, there are more problems. Sorry about that. We are all these children of Adam and Eve, so the problems are always there. Today you say that don't ask our children to watch the television very often. There is violence and there is crime, and they also develop their spirit. Which television program did Cain watch? Which television program did Cain watch? There's nothing. And there was no history of anyone murdering another person. Such a thing was not there at all. But nevertheless, the inherent sinfulness, which he got it from his parents who had committed sin, was there, and that gave vent at a moment of anger. Nobody knew how to murder another person. The first son of the first parents murdered his first brother. If that could happen that day, I think it can happen today. That's why we need to be extremely cautious today. That's why we need to be extremely careful in maintaining good interpersonal relationships. One of the reasons why we have lots of interpersonal relationship problems is because we judge in others what we excuse in ourselves. Let me say that. Normally, that's the endemic nature. We judge in others, or we condemn in others, what we excuse in ourselves. Turn with me to the 7th chapter of Matthew's Gospel again, and look at these words of Christ, which are so emphatic. Many times, we do not spend enough of time with the meditation of the Sermon on the Mount of the Lord Jesus Christ. I strongly advise that every 6 months, at least once, go through the 5th, 6th and 7th chapters of the book of Matthew, and one sitting, you just finish reading. Because that will be a review for your Christian life. That is the Magna Carta of the Kingdom of God. That is the kingdom principle that Christ has laid for us as the King. Judge not that you be not judged. With what judgment you judge, you will be judged. And in the same measure you use, it will be measured back to you. Why do you look at the speck in your brother's eye, but don't consider the plank in your own eye? How can you say to your brother, let me remove the speck out of your eye, and look, the plank is in your own eye? Hypocrite. Hypocrite. There also the word hypocrite comes. First, remove the plank from your eye. Again, insert the word first. First, remove the plank from your own eye. And then you will see clearly to remove the speck out of your brother's eye. Maybe we can just recollect how many people we have judged, and how many people we have criticized, and how many people we have unrighteously and incorrectly blamed. If you just quietly sit, and without any compromise, if you would put your mind into a self-interrogation, you would find, if a person keeps on judging another person in a particular issue, normally, that person will be guilty of that particular sin, and it is one way of escaping the condemnation and the guilt that comes upon him. He throws that in another person. Usually, this is what we find, especially when we deal with people who are filled with bitterness and they come to us for counseling. Invariably, we find that when you excuse yourself of something in your own life regularly, you start condemning it and judging others for it. Beware. What is that you have to put right with people who are known to you? Maybe it's a family member with whom you have to go and shake hands and say, I'm sorry. Then comes the question, who should go? Whether the offender should go or the offended should go. That's always the question, right? And invariably, we are the offender. We never say that we are the offenders. Who should go? In Matthew's Gospel, 5th chapter, which I just now read out to you, who is the offender? You are the offender. That is why your brother has got something against you. Now, I would take you to another passage, and I will ask you who offender is in that particular issue. Matthew's Gospel, 18th chapter. Matthew's Gospel, 18th chapter, and look at the 15th verse. Moreover, if your brother sins against you, now who is the offender? Your brother is the offender. You are the offender. In Matthew's 5th chapter, who is the offender? You are the offender.
My brother is the abundant. That's why he has got something in it. But now here, there's a shift. If your brother sins against you, let him come or you go? You go. So whether you are the offender or the offended, you who want to live right with God, you who want your offerings accepted by God, you who want to grow up in your Christian spiritual maturity, you go. That was Zacchaeus. He wanted to see Jesus, you know, he was too short to see Jesus in a big crowd. He climbed upon a tree. Before he saw Jesus, Jesus saw him. He simply wanted to see Jesus, but Jesus wanted to stay with him. Zacchaeus, today I'm going to stay with you. He's like Jack and Jill tumbling down, the fellow came to coming down, and he ran quickly, and he was there at his doorstep before Jesus would walk. What did he say? Before he would say, welcome Jesus, or arrange for a big party, you know what he said? He did what we are all supposed to do. If I have taken anything wrongly from others, I will return it fourfold. Because that is the requirement of the Old Testament law. As a tax collector, he would have definitely taxed people more than what was due, or he would have received lots of bribes and tips. He's implied in the passage. I will give fourfold of all that I have if I have wronged anyone. And Jesus said, today, salvation has come to this house. Just think of things while you have to reconcile with people. You know, those days, especially under the ministries of Charles Finney, John Wesley, and in India, there are some of the great evangelists who spoke that old-time repentance, not just blessing. They talked about repentance and then blessing. And they used to emphasize this truth of reconciliation with men and restitution of matters which needed to be put right. But these days, there is very conveniently laid aside. Reconciliation with men and restitution of matters may not be a condition for salvation, but definitely they are evidence of salvation. When Christ comes into your life, dirty things will need to go out. Things which you need to put right. Maybe as you are sitting under the preaching of my word, the word of God tonight, think of people whom you have wronged, whom you have abused, whom you have judged unkindly, and gave them unkindness cuts many times, thinking that you are always superior to others, and you know it all. Considering everybody else foolish and stupid. Or cheating somebody. Tonight, go to that person. But nowadays it's very easy. You can even dial to the person. And say, I'm sorry. Don't try to justify your name and wound that person further. You know, many times when you go for reconciliation, we again go for a big explanation. Don't do it. Make it very short and crisp and brief. I'm sorry, brother. I'm sorry, sister. I spoke against you. I shouldn't have done it. I'm sorry. If any explanation has been let that person give, but you don't offer any explanation. Bite your tongue if you want to make a second sentence. Now these are practical exhortations I'm giving you. If this way the peace of God and the peace among one another will be restored to the church, I tell you, it can be true about every congregation. Because how good, how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. There, the Lord does not just send his blessings. My Bible says, the Lord commands his blessings. Nothing can stop. No revival blessing can stop to flow into a congregation while people go to reconcile one another and fuse in love. Oh, for such a revival. We have seen all sorts of revival. Singing revival we have seen, worship revival we have seen, shouting revival we have seen, falling revival we have seen, laughing revival we have seen. But we must have a weeping revival. There's the need of the hour. There is sanctifying value in tears. much as in you, live peaceably with all men.
Do your best.
But you can say, no, brother, there are some people just impossible. But my Bible says, please turn with me, Romans 12th chapter. Now today is just Sunday, so we don't need to rush through the message. Because even in the morning services, we hear only shorter sweet sermons, 20 minutes. So I think, don't hesitate to listen to this talk, even though I go a little lengthy. Romans 12th chapter, 18th verse. If it is possible, as much as depends on you. Underline that word, you. I like that. As much as depends on you. In other words, you must do your maximum. Go second mile. If necessary, go even third mile. And if you had already gone third mile, why not the fourth mile? As much as depends on you. In other words, you should be able to say, brother, I have exhausted all possibilities. Nothing more I can do. But if there is something you think I can do, tell me. I am ready to do that also. I will take another step. Live peaceably with all men. We cannot dispose of any person saying, oh, you know, he won't listen, she won't listen. Do all that is possible. Do it again. There is no heart that cannot be measured by the love which flows from charity. Jesus Christ was on the cross. And there the Lord Jesus Christ spoke seven words or seven sayings. First say is on forgiveness. Have we forgiven everyone? Have we forgiven everyone? Or are you holding bitterness and grudge and vengeance against anyone? Beloved, let me tell you. Vengeance is not yours. Vengeance is the Lord's.
Is vengeance right? Vengeance is right. But we humans are not capable of handling vengeance.
Only the Lord can handle vengeance properly.
So don't take the sword in your hand.
Leave the battle into the hand of the Lord. Fight in your heart from that agitation, that tempest, the tumult.
Fight in your heart. Trust in Him. Do not fret.
That's the way we could restore peace. And when we would close our eyes, breathing our last, there should be no one, no man, no woman whom we will leave behind on this face of the earth unforgiven. Let's have a sweet death. I once preached a message, how to die triumphantly. People didn't like that message because you should talk about how to live victoriously. But here this man's very message is how to die triumphantly. What does he think about us? But I preached and they appreciated it. Read the Bible to find out how to die triumphantly. The first thing, if you want to die triumphantly, is that don't leave anybody unforgiven here. You know why? We are going to a place where people are there because and only because they are forgiven by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the land of forgiveness. We are going to a land of forgiveness. Let us not leave anybody without forgiveness either. Your heart will be sweet and you will feel light. Sometimes we feel very heavy in our relationships, right? And very tight also. Just relax and say sorry. How many times? Once. Twice, thrice, four times, five times, six times, seven times, not in a week, but in a single day. If you remember the scripture proper. In a single day, if seven times my brother sins against me, every time he comes, I'm sorry, brother. Okay, don't worry. Second time, I'm sorry. Okay. That is, every 2 hours he comes to you, you know, when you are awake. Should I go to that extent? Peter asked the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus said, No. That is too little. You need to go still further. Not seven times. 70 times? And immediately, you know what the apostle said? I don't know how many of you have noticed it. They said, forgiving an erring brother 7 times a day itself is very difficult. And you are asking us to forgive him 70 times 7, 490 times. If that we have to do, we better increase our faith. You know, we use that word increase our faith for all sorts of things. But that prayer, increase our faith, was in the context of forgiveness. To forgive an erring brother, you need more faith than performing a miracle, I tell you. Miracles are just like that happen in the sovereign will of God. But to forgive someone who keeps on erring and hurting you, and causing pain and inflicting pain upon you, to forgive him, like the apostles were also need to ask, Lord, give us more faith. But God will do it. What did Jesus say? He did not immediately say, okay, I give you a lot of faith. No! He said, if you have faith as the size of a mustard seed. In other words, start forgiving people for small errors, small mistakes, small offenses. If you learn to forgive people for small offenses, forgiving them for greater offenses becomes easy. That's the lesson of the passage. Are you with me? Do you follow what I'm trying to say? I know that we are reading many of our lives during the course of this message. Now, I have struggled with lots of people to reconcile with them. You know, basically, I am a proud person. I still remember, you know, when I was in high school, I think that was the day when they were trying to make some sentences for the word proud. I remember our class teacher, I don't know why he did it, I don't think anybody should do it. On the blackboard he wrote, you know, sentence making, Stanley is a proud word. Now, I was the first rank student, but I had my own pride. You know, that pride I inherited from my dad, who was a military officer. He always walked proud. So that runs in our family. So I was naturally very proud. Even now, unless I take conscious and consistent effort to have the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ deeply work in me and deeply in me, that will suffice. So each of us, we've got our own temperaments, isn't it? Our own temperaments. And those temperaments should not become a matter of excuse for us. Oh, that's my temperament. Temperaments must be renewed and reformed, and that should be brought under the Spirit's control. It needs to be given the first place in our lives, priorities. First one, inward purity. And the second one is matters of eternal value. And the third one, right relationships. Now the fourth one I would like to think with you as a matter of priority is Bible meditation. Bible meditation. Please turn with me to the book of Romans, 3rd chapter. And I will read the first two verses to you. Romans 3, 1 and 2. Yes, I will read for you. I will read all the references so that it becomes easy for you and that will be legible. 3, 1 and 2. What advantage then has the Jew? Or what is the profit of circumcision? You know, he talks about, he just argues. Is the Jew at an advantageous position? And does he have something to be meritorious about? And in verse 2 he says, much in every way. Chiefly because, insert the word chiefly. Chiefly because to them were committed the oracles of God. What was the greatness about the people of Israel or the people of God? Yesterday, a day before, I just quoted that text. Moses was standing before God's people. You know what he said? There is no nation as great as you, because to no other nation God gave these many statutes and commandments. So our greatness is in having the word of God. But when the Bible is not given due place, we lose all our significance on the face of this earth. I will say something, but that is truth. It may be difficult, but that's truth. England made a Shakespeare. blame England. I don't know how many of you can agree to it. England made the Shakespeare, but the Bible made England. But when England forgot the Bible, you know what has happened to this country today. There will come a time, according to the best Bible scholars in England, maybe in another 5-10 years, England will no more be a Christian nation, it will be a Muslim country. There are many churches in England which don't have enough of offering even to maintain the room heater. And they are sold out in the market for malls or at least for a mosque. This is the country which once sent us missionaries. Now, my perhaps great-great-grandfather was the convert of one of the missionary efforts of British missionaries from England. And they are the people who first printed for us the King James Version of the Bible, which is still the most beloved version in the whole world. They simply supplied the Bibles, but they never applied the Bibles. And you know what has happened to them today. All that England has today is its past glory. We claim that the Bible is the best seller, number one best seller. Yes! But the sad story is, more copies of the Bible are sold than the copies which are read. There are so many parents sitting here. I want to read 2 verses to you from the book of Hosea. Turn with me to the book of Hosea. Hosea comes after Daniel. Daniel and then Hosea. That book has got tremendous message about the Word of God. Book of Hosea, 4th chapter. And the 6th verse. 4:6 of Hosea. My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Because you have rejected knowledge, I will also reject you from being priest for me. Because you have forgotten the law of your God, I will also forget your children. Shall I paraphrase this statement for you, beloved? Parents, who find yourselves too busy with too many things, but find no time for the Bible, and you have forgotten the Bible, God is so angry with you that He says, because you have forgotten my word, God does not say I will forget you, but He says I will forget your children. Because we love our children more than we love ourselves, isn't it? How many days and weeks and months pass out without spending sufficient unhurried time in the meditation of God's word? Come to the 8th chapter of the same book of Hosea and look at the 12th verse. I have written for him the great things of my law. The Bible is a great book. I have written for him the great things of the law, but they were considered a strange thing. They never took it personally for them. Okay, that's an option. Back to the Bible. Day before yesterday I insisted that every one of you, you get a copy of some Bible reading plan by which you can read through the entire Bible once every year or in 2 years' time. Now, I don't want to put you to shame or feel you, make you feel guilty, but I'm asking you a question. How many of you can honestly say that as a Christian for 20 years, 30 years, or 35 years, you have read through the Bible at least once from Genesis to Revelation? Will you please put up your hand? Don't worry. I'm not just going to say anything. Because I told you, it's not criticizing or condemning. Just put up your hand, don't hold it. How many of you have read through the Bible at least once? You know, it's hardly 20%. No wonder Hosea said, I gave them my law. They considered it a strange thing. That's not something that is related. That's not something that is necessary for us. It's just an optional thing. It's not a major, it's only a minor subject. Will we decide tonight? I plead with you, dear brothers and sisters. If you want to be the kind of Christian God wants you to be, it's impossible apart from the Bible. How did you know that Jesus died? Did you get any photograph or somebody photographing the Lord Jesus Christ when he was crucified by the cruel Roman soldiers? No. How do you know that Jesus died? How do you know that Jesus rose again? Is it just because your grandfather told you? But who told your grandfather? How do you know? According to the scriptures, Christ died, and that's what we believe. According to the scriptures, Christ rose again, and that's what we believe. So the word of God for our lives as Christian is inseparable. Going through the forms and motions, like going to the church and then giving some offerings and then participating in communion, at least on festival days. Now all these things are ceremonies and they lose all their significance and meaning if we don't have a walk with God in the light of His word. I can't overemphasize the importance of the word of God in the lives of the people of God. So may I plead with you, dear friends, tonight that in 2008, whether or not you do anything, keep this target. And you will read through the Bible. Maybe several times you started with Genesis, stopped with Exodus, or stopped with Deuteronomy. Or when you came to some of the books of the Old Testament, they were very disinteresting and you stopped them. But I want you to go through this exercise. Even if it may look very legalistic, still it is taught. Because many times we say, oh, that's legalism, this is legalism. And we finally lose the discipline also. So decide that you will be through the Bible this year. And you write to me next year. You can just contact me on my email, IIT Chennai@bible.com. You write to me whether I'm going through the Bible or just church has done you any substantial good or not. I guarantee you will be the never same again. The word of God cleanses you. The word of God builds you up. Because it is the word of God's grace. It is able to build us up. Some of our inner life, our inner man is broken down, shattered. He's in shambles. We need to rebuild, reconstruct, and restore. The only way is coming back to the Bible. What is the great advantage of the people of God? Chiefly because to them is given the word of God. I gave them my law, but they considered it a strange thing. They have forgotten my law, I will forget their children. Let not that happen to any of us. We can't afford to lose our children. We can't afford to lose our children to the devil. We want our children to be in the center of God's will. Because the world our children are going to live in is going to be much more difficult than the world that we grew and lived in. You can lay the foundation. First in your life. By taking the word of God seriously and giving its due place in your life. Fifthly, the fifth thing I would like to talk about by way of Christian priorities or the first things in our life, wholehearted worship. Wholehearted worship. Our wholehearted devotion. Turn with me to Matthew 22nd chapter. I read from verse 35 to verse 38. A very familiar passage, but look at them again. One of them, a lawyer, Matthew 22:35 onwards, one of them, a lawyer, asked Jesus a question, testing him and saying, "Teacher, which is the great commandment of the law?" Jesus said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind." All. Nothing excluded. All aspects, heart, soul, and mind. How about you differentiate it? The entire personality involved. That's what it means. And in another place it says, with all your strength also. That means the physical body also is involved. And he said, this is the first and great commandment. Encircle the word first. This is the first and great commandment.
You know, God gave the people of Israel 10 commandments. Which is the first commandment? I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt and have no other gods before me.
That's good enough, isn't it? But in the second commandment also, he amplifies and practically explains the first commandment. You shall not have any idols.
You know, if you just very carefully look at it, the first commandment, second commandment could have been clubbed together.
But God deliberately wanted the law of repetition to explain to us at that point that not only that we should give our wholehearted devotion to God, we also should not allow anything else to take the place of God in our lives as an idol.
When we say worship, I talk about the time we spend with God in personal prayer and communion and fellowship with Him. How is your prayer life, brother? How is your prayer life, sister? God has given us 24 hours a day. How much time you spend for all your personal, practical, physical needs? And how much time do you spend with Him?
That question Jesus Christ asked in the Garden of Gethsemane, I believe, is still valid today.
What did He say? Could you not watch with me for 1 hour?
I think we all talk about tithing. It's easy to tithe your treasure, but I'm talking about tithing your time. What is tithing of 24 hours? It is 2 hours plus.
You don't even need to give 1/10.
How about 1/30 at least?
Which is 1 hour plus. Again, you round it off.
Just 1 hour.
Are you too busy? Any one of you? To spend one full hour, quality hour, with God in prayer and meditation and communion with Him?
If you are too busy to spend 1 hour with God, sorry brother, sorry sister, you are too busy.
Who gave you job?
It's God who gave you job.
Is the job taking the place of the blessed?
Who gave you material provisions?
God.
Who gave you help to do your job or go on with your employment?
God.
What is that you have which you have not received from God?
If that be the case, how do you acknowledge it?
If it cannot be by at least spending 1 hour with
Him. 1 hour.
Now there again a question. Brother, is it so easy? Okay, let me give you a simple principle, procedure. Start with 15 minutes. Just 15 minutes. Instead of starting with 1 hour and crash landing the next month, you start with 15 minutes and build block over block. That is easier to maintain. Now most of what I'm telling you have been lessons taught me by my mentors. They are not simply theories, they have been tested in the animal of experience. Start with 15 minutes a day. And during the 15 minutes, you know what you should do? When you pray, enter your room, and then close the door, that is important. Entering the room alone is not enough. You should close the door. And if Jesus were here today, physically, and given that exhortation, you know what He would have said? Switch off your cell phone. I don't know about Australia, but in India, how many times when we are praying, meditating the Bible, suddenly the telephone rings and you run to the telephone, take up the receiver, only to find wrong number. Even for a wrong number, we rush so much. While we are talking to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, if the call would wait for another half an hour and you would not answer the call for another half an hour, the world would not crumble. Nothing would come. Sunday mornings. What a meaningless expectation. How unlawful are we? Who made such a cheap God? It is not the God of the Bible. It's something else. It's another idol. Enter your room. Close the door. Switch off your cell phones. And the moment you enter that room, let people in your home know that you have gone to meet with your God. If you don't have a prayer room because your house is not so big, you at least create a prayer corner. And tell your family people, when I am in prayer and meditation, do not disturb me. Do not tell me anything. Why not? Why not such holy habits and the wartime spiritual exercises of the wartime religion be restored to our rank and file of modern Christians? Why not, I ask? Is it asking for too much, Pastor? I'm asking for something very normal, quite legitimate. That's why Jesus asked that question. Could you not watch with me for at least 1 hour? What does it mean? Jesus was in agonizing death. He was sweating blood. You would have seen people bleeding. But I don't think you would have any chance seeing somebody sweating blood. Sweating blood is there only when your spirit and your inner man is going through inexplainable agony and anguish. Sweat drops, fell as drops of blood, the Bible says. No exaggeration. So how long he was there, we don't know. Maybe he was there for 5 or 6 hours in that garden. Because it was his usual custom to go to the garden with the disciples for prayer. It won't be just 15 minutes, 20 minutes. I'm sure it was a lengthy season. And he didn't want his disciples to stay awake for 5 hours. Of his resolute prayer, he would have expected them to be awake at least for 1 hour. Even that they did not know. They not only slept, they also slumbered. They not only slumbered, perhaps they were snoring. All because they did not grow in the school of prayer along with the Lord. They watched him pray, but they never learned to pray. You may have 101 spiritual activities in your life, but nothing is more important than prayer. A praying man will stop sinning and a sinning man will stop praying. Prayer has got a detrimental effect on our holy walk with God. Communion with the Lord. The greatest of all questions that Jesus asks us tonight is not what you do for me, but do you love me? Why that question? If you love somebody, you would like to spend time with that somebody. Love demands time. And every family which has gathered here, come here tonight. In arrangement, the husband and the wife with the spouses, and parents with the children and children with the parents, decide for a prayer time. If you don't fix up a prayer time, you never find time. Fix up a prayer time. Sixthly, the priority that we need to think about in our Christian life is family peace. Family peace. Family problem is an universal problem. One of the American presidents 10-15 years ago was asked a question by a religious columnist. This is what he asked, Mr. President. What do you think is number one problem in America? The answer was broken families. But I think the answer was right and wrong. It is not only number one problem of America, it is the number one problem of every country in the world. Broken families. That is why the Lord Jesus Christ, when he sent his disciples, you know what he told them? When you enter into a house, first say peace. First, turn to the passage. Luke 10 and verse 5. Luke 10 and verse 5. Again, it was not the first 12, but it was the next 70. He took 70 disciples and paired them as teams of 2 by 2. And then he sent them. He said in verse 5, whatever house you enter, first say, listen to the word first. First say, peace to this house. I thank God that we have almost an equal number of men and women here. But very sadly, what we notice is our meetings more of ladies and less of men, but we have good balance here. So I tend to understand that people have come as families. Praise God for that. I wish you were also seated as families here. Some of them are you, but several of you have not been sitting as families for whatever reason, but I believe that when you get back home tonight, husband and wife, I would like you to have a talk with each other. To settle matters which are still fuming within you. No one is perfect. Don't try to find fault with another person. Without two hands, that you cannot climb. So for no problem, either the husband alone is the cause or the wife alone is the cause. Usually, for any family problem, both the spouses are responsible. So there needs to be a lot of give and take. Because if you are not living at peace, your children will smell it. And they will develop their future according to what they have seen here at home. Unless they decide to do things on the negative side. So remember, if you allow things to come between you and your wife, between you and your spouse, and if there is a gap, and then in course of time that gap becomes a gulf, you would be setting up a very, very bad example for the children. And tomorrow, when your children get married, and you get news that there's sort of problem in the families, you can't do anything about it, because that might be too late at the time. In order that there may be a peace between husband and wife, there's no ideal husband in the world, and there's no ideal wife in the world, and there's no ideal family in the world. I hope you all know that. We are all human beings with lots of defects. We are all weak, but each person's weakness is in a different area. Nobody is a jug of all odds. We all have our weaknesses. And we need to spend time with each other, understand and appreciate and even out matters. If you're angry with your spouse, you know what the Bible says? Be angry, but sin not. How is it possible? Be angry, but sin not. Is there a sinful anger and sinless anger? Of course, yes. You know what the Bible says next? Let your anger go down before the sun goes down. In other words, the maximum time allowed for any anger to remain is if the anger spotted out at morning 6 o'clock, before evening 6 o'clock, that must be sorted out. Go to your parents. With that anger still hard for it. Keep short accounts with one another. Don't try to justify when you discuss matters. Especially I want to talk to husbands. We husbands feel that we are always right. We normally feel like that. We are always right. But you are wrong if you feel that way. The other person could be right as well. You know, when you are a real man, and you are able to tell your wife, yes, I'm sorry, what you have said is fine. I should have done it that way. That time only you become a real man. Until then, you are another woman. When you enter a house, say peace. May the Lord of peace and may the God of all comfort work out an unusual, ununderstandable peace in the hearts and minds of all those who are under the roof of our house and make our home a little heaven on earth. Family is such a beautiful thing. That is why the church is called a family. And the company in heaven is called a family. And God himself calls himself his father, and he calls his son as son. The picture of family runs everywhere, all through. In all the economy of God, we see that beautiful picture of family. Do you have a family altar? Do you have a family altar? Is that a prayer time? Now we say, no, no, morning, we are all very busy, we get up late, and then we just go out for work, and then lunch we don't come back, it's okay. But I tell you, usually, a time before supper is the ideal time for family altar. Make sure that all your children, unless otherwise they are on an extremely important assignment, they are back home for family prayer. Stress on them. Become strict with the children on that. I want to thank God for my mommy. My daddy was never with us because my daddy was in the military and he would come once a year for 14, 15 days from the army. He was in the front line. So mommy, she had to bring us up, you know, me and my younger brother. Every day she would kneel down with us and there were times, you know, when mommy keeps on lengthening her prayer, we'll fall asleep. Doesn't matter, she'll continue. And then she'll wake us up to say the Lord's Prayer. But it has finished. It is there in the family prayer I learned to be on my knees straight and pray. If you regularly kneel down and pray, you can postpone your arthritis. I won't say you won't get it. Now the kneeling posture is a forgotten posture these days. I want to tell you, kneeling is not a cultural thing. It's a biblical thing. Daniel knelt down and prayed. If he had not knelt down and prayed, the king and the people would not have come to know that he was praying, in spite of the decree that was passed in the kingdom. He knelt down and prayed. I'm put to shame every time I travel to the Middle East. Several times I go to the Middle East for ministry. We are flying up on the plane. But if there is one Muslim, maybe from India or from elsewhere, maybe he is a joining person, at the time of his prayer, he takes a small towel, he walks towards the toilet, just in the small space there is in the toilet. He spreads it and he kneels down and prays to his Allah. My Christians, I want to ask you a question. What are you ashamed of? Some of us today behave so unnaturally and abnormally and artificially when we are put on the airplane. But this man never forgets his Allah, wherever he is. If it is a railway station, you should come to India and see some railway station. If the train stops for 5 minutes and 10 minutes, if it is a prayer time, you'll find all the Muslims there in that train. Maybe 14 bogies or 25 bogies. They all quickly come to a certain point. They'll just quickly have 2 minutes prayer and then they'll all get back. Because they say, whatever may be the reason, whatever may be the condition, we have an Allah God who we need to pray. Are you worshipping a living God? Is your God is the God of Daniel? Jesus, in spite of his agony in the Garden of Gethsemane, he fell flat prostrate before his Father and he prayed. Restore kneeling posture in your home, especially in your family altar. Don't have the habit of just crossing one leg over the other, not even removing your sandals. Where did you learn all that stuff? You wouldn't have learned it from the Bible. Where did you learn that garbage? Kneel down because we are kneeling down before a holy God. In the Bible, so many times we have said, kneel down before your Maker. Maybe I sound very old time, but I'm sorry about it. I'm not able to change. Because I'm stuck with the Bible. Kneel down before your Maker. seventhly and lastly, that we should have as a priority in our lives, worldwide evangelization. Worldwide evangelization. Turn with me to Mark's Gospel, 13th chapter. Mark chapter 13. And look at verse 3. Now as Jesus sat on the Mount of Olives opposite the temple, Peter, James, John and Andrew asked him privately, "Tell us, what will these things be? What will be the sign when all these things will be fulfilled?" And Jesus gave a long list of things they should be careful about. And he climaxes it in verse 10. Look at the verse 10. And the gospel must first be preached to all nations. Put those two words together. The gospel must be published, and the gospel must first be published. I like the word. The gospel must be published, and the gospel must first be published to all the nations. And then the end shall come. Is that your priority? Friends, missionary work is not an option. It is an obligation on every one of us. That day, when God asked Adam, "Why are you?" He said, "I'm hiding." That first question most of us have answered. But there comes the second question. Where is your brother? And invariably we answer that question with an excuse. Am I my brother's keeper? I ask you, if you are not your brother's keeper, who else is your brother's keeper? Thank God he has raised Missions Fellowship Australia just about 1 year ago. Thank God for the hundreds of missionary organizations God has raised all across the world. I told you that the consuming passion of my life from day one of my conversion as a pre-university class student was to somehow tell as many people as possible that Jesus saves their people from their sins. Sometimes in the youth forums, young people ask me a question, "Uncle, how did you come into full-time ministry?" And I tell them, I did not have a dramatic experience of God's call in my life. Whether it was in the college, or whether it was in the institute, or whether it was in my career in the hospital, I was doing 101 things, but that which was standing out was that every person who I could come across should be told of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I went to Orissa. Orissa is one of the backward states in India. I took some friends and I went to some of the tribal villages. And nobody asked me to go. I went. And I wanted to see. I have read all these things only in books and magazines. I read about David Livingstone going into the African jungles. And David Livingstone was not an ordinary guy. He was not a school dropout. He was a scientist. He was a geologist. He had a doctorate. And since he said he was not an ordinary man, he was perhaps the most famous cricketer England had ever produced. He was not a school dropout. He went to Africa. Some of the geniuses, some of the great intellectual giants, at some point of time, they wanted to go and see the unreached people. So I went to Orissa with some of our college friends. I saw the people. I was talking about so many facilities in my life, and there were people who didn't even have proper clothing. I stayed in a tribal hut. It's just about 10 feet by 10 feet. At the center, they had a place where it was a fireplace, because it's a pretty cold place. And that was all the warmth they could get. And one corner, there was some chicken. Another corner, there were some pigs and piglets. And the family was sleeping on the other corner, and we as guests, we had to just bend ourselves and enter in. Because that's the way they had built their huts. That's why the animals come and attack them. And we were given another corner. Everybody went to sleep. I was awake the whole night. I saw the need. I came to see his hospital where Laura, and I met with my director. And I told him, "Sir, I would like to resign. I was the most qualified engineer there in the same hospital at that time. And he said, "Are you all right?" I said, "Yes." He said, "Where do you want to go?" "I just want to go. I have seen the need." And he told me, "Anytime you want to come back, you're quite welcome." And I told my wife, she said, "You could have done it much earlier." No regrets. There is only one life. That life will soon be passed. And what is done for Christ alone shall last. What shall it profit a man if he gains the whole world but loses his own soul? How shall we escape? Not how shall you escape, but how shall we escape if we fail or neglect to share this great message of salvation to those who are destitute and void of this gospel message? There was Andrew. He started following Jesus, then he found Jesus, the Messiah. You know what the Bible says? Turn with me. The book of John, first chapter. We are talking about first things. John, first chapter. I read you verses 40 to 42. So illustrative of what each one of us is supposed to do. One of the two who heard John speak and followed Jesus was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first found his own brother Simon. Encircle the word first. He first found his own brother Simon, and he said to him, "We have found the Messiah." And he brought him to Jesus. This is the most beautiful language. He brought him to Jesus. There is no greater service that you and I can do to our fellow men than bringing them to Jesus. Amen. He brought him to Jesus. And when Jesus looked at him, he said, "You are Simon the son of John." We don't read of Andrew much later on. We read about Peter, a pillar, a rock, the senior most apostle of the 12 member cabinet of the Lord Jesus Christ, to whom Jesus gave the keys of the kingdom. Everything wonderful. Andrew did not write any book for the New Testament, but Peter wrote. But who brought Peter to Jesus? There was one Andrew necessary to bring one Peter, and there was one Ananias necessary to baptize one Paul. God uses ordinary persons. If only they would follow his footsteps. Follow me, I will make you fishers of men. He did not say, "Follow me, I will bless you." Rather, he said, "Follow me, I will make you a blessing." Andrew followed Jesus. And God made him a blessing to Peter. Think of your friends with whom you have not yet shared the gospel. Think of your colleagues with whom you have not yet shared the gospel. Think of your neighbors with whom you have not yet given a Christian smile. Smile is the shortest distance between two people. Don't go parallel in this world. Come across people. Help them. They need the Savior. They were waiting for someone to help them. That man was lying down at the pool of Bethesda for 38 years. Why are they in this condition? The answer he gave is the answer that God tells us tonight. No man helped him. How shall they know unless somebody tells them? God cannot send angels from above to tell our people that Jesus came, Jesus lived, Jesus died, Jesus rose again, Jesus ascended, and Jesus is coming back. You are the mouth of Jesus. Your hands are the extension of the hands of Jesus. Your feet are the extension of the feet of Jesus. Jesus cannot go to people. Jesus cannot go to villages. You alone can go, because the Bible says, as Jesus was in the world, so we are in this world. Who is a Christian? He is Christ's agent. Who is a Christian? He is Christ's representative. Who is a Christian? He is Christ's apostle. Who is a Christian? He is Christ's messenger. To proclaim and to propagate the message of peace to regions beyond. You are coming from various churches, thank God for it. I want to ask you a question. What is the priority in your church budget?
Whitewashing,
changing the curtain, stitching the cushions, conditioning the hall, then finally, as if God will be displeased, missionary work.
What should be the priority has become the last item in our budget.
You know which is a missionary church? A missionary church is one in which supporting our missions and missionaries who would carry the gospel to regions beyond, to unreached places where the name of Christ is not even named once, that church is a missionary church.
Amen. Because I believe in tangibility. I don't believe in theory. Being an engineer myself, I believe in practical things.
Is your church a missionary church? Talk to your pastor. Talk to your elders. Talk to your seniors. Make sure that your church has missionary work as the first item in its budget. Because God is a missionary God. He sent His Son as a missionary. Jesus is a missionary. The Holy Spirit is a missionary. He is even today sending missionaries forth into this world. If God is a missionary God, those who follow Him cannot but be missionary minded. Pray regularly for mission work all over the world. Get as many mission periodicals as possible and include it in your family prayer. And give liberally to missionary work. Because missionary work is an expensive work. It demands more money than even the maintenance of the local church because they go to difficult places. Support them. Missionary praying, missionary giving, and missionary going.
First things first. Number one, inward purity. Number two, eternal values. Number three, right relationships. Number four, Bible meditation. Number five, wholehearted worship or devotion. Number six, family peace. And number seven, worldwide evangelization. If you would like to commit yourself to these priorities in your Christian life, it is not compulsory, but if you find it is necessary that you want to reprioritize your life on these seven first things which demands our prime attention, please stand in the presence of God. You don't need to stand up because others are standing up. It's not a one. But this is the time that we make a total commitment to God. Eyes closed. Whether you are sitting or standing, let's bow down. And hearts lifted up unto God. Oh God, too long I have been playing a hypocrite. Too long I have been living a double life. Help me, Lord, to come to peace, solace within myself. And be honest before you and before them. Help me, Lord, to give priority to eternal values in my life and not be just taken up with the mundane earthly things which perish. Help me, Lord, to put my relationships to the right with one another. And don't harbor anger or hatred or vengeance or jealousy or unforgiveness or bitterness. Help me to reconcile with whoever I think that I should set matters right. Give me the grace and humility to go and humble myself and do it with God. And Bible meditation. Oh God, you have given me your holy word, but I have considered it a strange thing. Forgive me, Lord. How many days have gone on without the meditation of your holy word? Forgive me, Lord. Sorry, Lord. Wholehearted worship has been a missing exercise in my life. Things have become very casual. It is not with all my heart, it's not with all my soul, it's not with all my mind, it's not with all my strength. It has been very casual. Bring me, Lord, back to the real utter seriousness. And help me, Lord, to consistently and constantly work for peace at home. Between spouses, between parents and children.
So a good Christian home may be able to heaven on earth. Is there any earlier heaven? Oh God, help me to pour myself, give myself in praying, in giving, and in going by a missionary enterprise, a worldwide evangelization. Help me, Lord, to do all that is possible in my lifetime, to see as many people as possible who are living without the gospel, to be reached with your gospel message. Because, Lord, I believe that this generation of Christians is responsible for this generation of non-Christians. If I don't go, if we don't give, who will do? Help us, O God, to realize this awesome responsibility and obligation that rests upon each of us. Oh, watch me if I preach not the gospel. Because necessity is light upon me. If I do it with pleasure, I have a great reward. Even otherwise, it's my duty. Thank you, Lord, for all these dear friends who have gathered here tonight and listened to this message so attentively. And thank you for their overwhelming response. I pray, O God, that the Holy Spirit shall continue to remind them of these decisions they have taken right at this moment in your presence, standing in the company of your saints. I pray that you continue to work with them and fulfill their good work at the beginning. We commit ourselves, O God, to these sevenfold priorities in our lives. To do these first things first. In Jesus' name we pray. As we keep standing, I would ask the pastor to give the benediction.
Praise God. A very timely, beautiful, and heartrending message from our dear pastor. And my dear brothers and sisters, thank you tonight for coming out in such large numbers. And it was very encouraging. But also send word around tomorrow that we have another service here, starting on the same time, 7 p.m. Once again, may God bless you. And it's great to have you, okay? So let's just bow our heads in prayer and give it all to God. And say, Lord God, thank you. And so awesome. Father God, we just bring our hearts before you, Lord. We lay our lives before you, Master. Lord, we open our lives for correction and for judgment and for discipline, and that you may enter again, and that you may cleanse us, and that, Lord, you may enable us to just look into that mirror that represents Jesus as our holy Lord and Savior. That, Father God, that as we go through the process of life, that we are earning our salvation with fear and trembling, and know that we serve an awesome God, a God who knows us in every possible way that man can be known, God. But he got so much that he gave his life for us on the cross, and did not shun from death, that even death could not hold him, but he rose from that death and came up and to give us life and life to the full. So Lord God, as we go on different ways today, Father God, I pray that you take us safely, covering us with the precious blood of Jesus, and renew us and revive us and restore us, so that we come back again tomorrow to listen to the word of God. Father, thank you for our dear pastor. Master, cover him and the ministry with the precious blood of Jesus. Father, that there be an awesome revival, Lord Father God, wherever he goes, Father God, and that men may come to Christ, and that they may give themselves to the Lord Jesus and be saved. I ask all of this in Jesus' name. Everyone says,
Amen.
Put your hands together and give glory to God.